like this. You got everything you need to win. You were born to do something awesome. There's no difference between me and you. No difference between those guys. What they did is they took their gift and they used it to serve their families. You take yours and serve yours.
Mr. Monty said here, did it for everybody in the world except his precious son. what it said. Do you know why you're not competing and winning? Your thermostat setting. Do you know why I didn't have to compete? I had it at 75 degrees. It's a terrible thing to believe about your own son. It's a terrible thing to believe about yourself. One day we played 9 holes and our life changed. Let me tell you what happened. You know what the dirty, the clean version, the profane version, or the BS version? Just want to say forgive me, because I probably shouldn't be cussing when I quoted scripture earlier, but I'm going to give you the real version, because it's got to be real. So here's what happened. We played 9 holes, and one of the professional players and his dad was in the group. We were way behind this day, like 30 minutes behind, because Max was playing so bad. We're down, we're in last place by 11 shots out of second to last place. And this tournament, when you walk, there's like, you pick up a quick sandwich, and you keep going at the 9th hole. Well, that day, the sandwiches were over there, and the 10th hole was like back in the road. It was too far. So the dad stops the boys, and our life changes in this instant. Watch this. Ready? Watch this. He goes, hey, to the other two guys. He goes, hey, guys, you guys go get your shots over there. Max. Max is out of it. He doesn't give a crap anyway. Max, go grab your lunch. Okay, here we go. I want a little creatine. I'm not going to lie at the time.
Chuck! What the fuck did you say to my son?
He's on the golf course.
Don't you ever fucking speak to my family like that and disrespect us again. You understand me?
Oh, by the way, we played a lot of golf with this dude. He was a nice man.
He had won on the professional tour, and his father had won on the professional tour, and his kids probably going to win on the professional tour. So you fucking talk to my family like that. You understand me? Hey, you guys go over there. Max, just stay with me.
I'm going to tell you the truth. The reason I tell you that story, my son that day had never heard me cuss before. He heard his mom a bunch, but never did.
My son's like, oh my God, Dad!
I said, come here! It's a true story. That's why I'm over here.
Max,
look at me.
Look around. We're gonna fucking win today, Max!
But he goes into this whole BS look around. I'll never forget it. Looks at the putt. I'm like, good job, Max. facts. Good job. It's like, yeah, okay, Dad. Never forget this. He goes, I think it's about a little downhill, about 2 feet left to right. And I go, you know what's crazy, man? I have no idea. That's exactly what I was seeing. Kind of looking at the other pro golfers for the read. They're not even giving me any feedback. I think you're right, Max. A little precious boy gets over the putt, lines it up for the first time in his life, is trying to win. Drains it for a birdie. Both of those guys made both. All right, hey, Max, how'd that feel? Never forget this year. Pretty good day. Never walk into the par five, and I watch him walk, and he's kind of like, hey, and he's talking shop with these guys. But, hey, guys, you know, playing Callaway's over here, taking a switch into Taylor Mays. You guys like your Taylor Mays, you know, that's what I'm thinking about going. Next hole's par five. Max drives it right down the middle again, par five driver. The other boys lay up. There's a lake in front of the green with a rock wall. He's got 210 yards. I go, Max, hit the three wood. He goes, Daddy, I can't. I go, hit the three wood. My son's never hit a three wood 210 yards. I go, Max, we're down 9 shots. Hit the three wood. No time to swings. So like any great story, there's a little Jesus involved in the story. So my son goes to take the club back, hits it, whoosh, and I immediately go into prayer mode. Like literally, like back to my past, like Our Father, Hail Mary, whatever you need, Lord. I remember literally thinking to myself, Lord, if this goes on this green, I will stop doing like 25% of all the bad crap I do. And also, I'll kick this in. If it hits the green, I'll acknowledge you in every talk I ever give. Because I talk to millions of people. And it hit the wall. From the green. Straight up in the air. And lands on the green. And rolls to about 2 inches from the hole. He gets up and taps in for the first eagle of his life. Now we're down seven. Fast forward to the 18th hole. We're down one. Numbnuts, who told us to grab his food earlier, and his kid are in first. What I tell my son not to do, by the way, it's a true story, not to take a what? Practice swing. Guess what he does on the most important shot of his uncoordinated life? Takes a practice swing, it's hot. All it flies out of his hands. Helicopters. Into the middle of the lake in front of the tee box. Most important shot of my son's life, he throws his own club into the lake. Yeah. Oh, God. What? I'm so sorry. Like, hey, buddy. Yeah, okay. Hey, power of one more club, man. We got another one here. Hit this three wood. And he hits the three wood down the middle. Walking down the fairway, I said, we're going to win. The little boy hits his ball in the lake. I said, Max, here's the deal. You got 114 yards. Hit this 8-iron, 10 feet left of the hole. Let's get out here with a W. We've never talked like this in our lives. And he hits it about 11 feet left of the hole. As we're walking up there, here's how this is going to work. If he makes the putt, we win. If he two putts, we go to a playoff with Numbnuts and his kid. If he three putts, we lose. And Mr. Mindset here, he's reading the putt. He goes through his little BS reading the putt. And I go, hey, this is how stupid I am. And I go, Max, it's a little downhill. You don't hit too far past the hole. Two putt, go to a playoff. Not the smartest thing to say. My kid, who never even thought about this before, looks at me like in disbelief and goes, look, he goes, Daddy, I'm gonna make it. We're gonna win. Now he's telling me. I go, we're not gonna go, man. Let's go. Sure enough, takes that putter back. And our life changed in one putt, on one day, in one round. Boom! Drains it. Yes, Max wins. Watch this. Completely different mindset because he began to believe. See, the people that you see get up here, here's the thing, we've got a little momentum, man. You start getting a few small wins, all of a sudden it starts stacking. You know anything about sports? It's not the best baseball team that just won the World Series. It's the Rangers. They weren't the best team in the league this year. Watch the NHL playoffs. It's the team with the hottest goaltender, man. Get to the playoffs. Sometimes it's the best team in football, but a lot of times it's the team with the, that's the healthiest, with the best defense, or the hottest offense. You gotta get momentum. And you get momentum by competing. Momentum makes an average person superhuman. Trust me, momentum is a magnifier. So look at this. He shot 64 that day. This is me and him and Cabo. I'm on a lot of great team here. Holy crap. That's me and him and Cabo. We're doing a DNA test currently to see who his real dad is because he's a giant. That's him signing his college golf scholarship.
Tell you this last.
My favorite thing to do in the world was to golf with my dad. Neither one of us were very good. But it was 5 hours with my best friend, right next to me. Do you know what I would give today to play one more golf round of golf with my dad? You think I'd rather have my island or play golf with my dad? You think I'd rather have a bunch of nice steak dinner with some great wine tonight? Or have a hamburger with that guy? That guy. This day we were playing golf, my dad had a deep voice like me. I said, what's going on with you, man? You need to get that checked. That was Saturday. Monday, he went to the doctor. Tuesday, he had a 12-hour surgery to move a tumor the size of a football from his chest. He's diagnosed with liposarcoma. When my dad got this cancer, he goes, look, man, here's the deal. I'll fight this thing one time, but I'm not going to lose my hair. I'm not going to get all wrinkled up. I'm not doing all that. I'll fight it once. I said, that's fair. Just fight it. Dad led him fighting it for 8 years. Cancer, then he went surgery, chemo, radiation, proton therapy, surgery, chemo, experimental chemo. Watch this. That's the same man. That's my dad. And every time I would see my dad, I'd say, Dad, you said you're in such pain. Why? You said you weren't going to go through this. He goes, listen to me. You could never play golf again. He goes, listen to me. It's only when you're threatened, Daddy, with not having one more day, that you understand the blessing and power of getting one more day. Don't wait till you can't have another one to appreciate the one you have now. God was using him to teach me a lesson to teach you. And he goes, you know what I will do? You know what kind of pain I'll go through to have one more dinner with your mom? You know what I'd do to have one more conversation with my son? Maybe get to one of my granddaughter's weddings? Maybe see my grandson play golf or basketball or football again, one of my grandsons? I'll do anything to get one more dinner. And so consequently, my dad would go through all that pain. Every time I'd see him, I knew I was losing my dad. Every time he's smaller and shrinking. You see what he's wearing, by the way? See the white shirt and the glasses? I taught my dad all the visualization techniques I teach in my book. And every day, even though he couldn't play golf, he'd take the time and visualize an entire round of golf with me. Every day, we'd play golf together in his mind. This is 8 months later.
Your sisters, please.
I called his dog. I That's my dad coming home one more time. Came through his front door one more time with the paramedics. That's my mom, his wife of 50 years, watching her husband come home one more time. My dad came through that front door, a totally different man. That's the same front door that I would sit in front of, terrified of who that man was going to come through the door. 45 years later, a totally different man came through that door. Kind, gentle, generous, helped thousands of other people. Someday, you are going to come home one more time. You are. Who do you want to be in that moment? What do you want to felt, seen, experienced, accomplished, the memories with your family? Who do you want to become? Those of you that are married or have somebody you love, someday your husband, your wife, will come through the front door only one more time. What do you want to share and experience? What do you want your kids, when they gather around you, or your grandchildren, or your parents someday, to say in celebrating the life you've lived? Who do you want to be when you have one more name? That staircase to the right is the same staircase I would send my mother up to hide. The paramedic is standing next to the liquor cabinet that I would have him avoid. Same home, same man, totally different human being. I'm not in this business because I think someone can change their life. I know it because I watched my hero do it. You got me? Now watch this. This is my dad with one more hour. Who do you want to be when you have one more hour? What do you want people to feel? What do you want to feel? What do you want to think about? What do you want to celebrate? What do you want to see? Who do you want to become? What do you want your life to have looked like? Because remember something, brother or sister. You were born to do something great with your life. And I don't know if it's in all these big ways, but I know this, the man who helped my dad, that was huge. Helping one person. About 20 minutes after I took this picture, my dad woke up and he went, "Poof." His eyes opened and he goes, "I'm so proud of you. I can't believe God gave you to me as my only son. I love you." He closed his eyes. 20 minutes later, he took one more breath. Someday you'll take one more breath. Someday I will. I think about it all the time. I live my life working towards that day. I make mistakes all the time. I screw up all the time. But I know where I'm going. And I know what I want it to look like when I get there. Do you? Do you? See, when you see a rich family, I gotta leave. But when you see a rich family, I want you to understand something. Oh, by the way, I'll help you out here. If you scan that, I'll give you all my free stuff. Literally just here to help you today. You scan that. Get on, I have nothing to sell you. Just take that and I'll give you all my free stuff. Okay, they'll send you something. I don't know what it is, but it's free. There's no upsell, there's no funnel, there's nothing, don't worry. If you don't get that scan, go to edmylife.com, put your email in there. Go to Instagram, follow my podcast. Let me say something to you. When you see a rich family, just remember this. You see a rich family, or maybe just a happy, peaceful family. Remember something, somewhere back in that family's lineage, They weren't rich. They weren't happy. And guess what happens in those families? The one shows up. In every family, eventually, the one shows up. And that person, that one, changes that family forever. I'm the one in my family. The world doesn't have their thumb on my legs anymore. We don't think like we used to think. We make a difference in the world. We get a decent education. We're calling the damn shots. The world doesn't put their thumb on my lips anymore. Your family needs you to be the one. And here's the cool thing. It's never who you think it is. Nobody would ever pick this alcoholic little boy's son to be the one. But they didn't know my heart. So you cut open a LeBron. You cut open a Beyonce. You cut open a winner. You cut open a great pastor, a great mother, a great business leader. We all look different. Different ethnicities, different bloodlines, different faith, different everything. But inside, you cut them open, their hearts look exactly the same. You either got the heart of a champion and a winner or you don't. It comes down to your heart. And I got that heart. I'm the one in my family. If you're feeling something when I'm speaking, you're the one. You're the one. You are the one. It's not too late for your family. I'll leave you with this. There's this great doctor named Dr. Attritional character is one who, in a single generation, changes the entire course of a lineage. And it's never who you think it is. The changes might be for good or ill, but the most noteworthy examples are those individuals who grew up in an abusive or emotionally destructive environment or a poor environment and somehow find a way to metabolize the poison and refuse to pass it on to their children. They refute the observation that abused children become abusive parents, that children of alcoholics become alcoholic adults, that poor children have to be poor adults. Their contribution to humanity is to filter the destructiveness out of their own lineage so that the generations downstream will have a supportive foundation upon which to build productive lives. I came all the way here today to paint one picture for you. You're the one. You're the one. And when you begin to step into that and own it and decide, I'm going to do this for my family, that you're going to step into that and own that for your family, something special happens. Last thought, I want you to go to heaven. I don't mean that metaphorically, I mean that literally, but I'm going to do it metaphorically for people who have other beliefs because I respect your beliefs. I respect that you have the beliefs. Let me tell you what I think heaven looks like in addition. I think when you get there, you meet the man or woman you could have been, that you're actually born to be. And when I get there, I'll go, hey man, I've been chasing you all my life. I've been chasing you. And I want me to look back to ultimately go, hey man, I saw you. Man, that one time I thought you completely blew it. That one was a huge mistake. That one we're not even going to talk about over there. But man, every time you started to get up, you kept getting up, you kept getting up, you kept getting up. And man, you did it. You maxed out your life. You have all the memories, the moments, the difference, the time with your family. You made yourself proud of yourself, man. You maxed out your life. To me, that's heaven. That's heaven. Hell looks like this. I was chasing you, and I got up, and I didn't, and then the market, and this person, and you don't know, and then I was gonna, and then, shit. Yeah, I saw that, and then you just quit trying anymore. Why? Why'd you quit? And if you get there, let me tell you what the answer will be if you quit. Let me tell you the honest answer. Here's what it's gonna be. I was afraid. I was more afraid than I loved my family. My fear was greater than my love for my family, if I'm being really honest. I lived my life afraid. I was afraid I wasn't good enough, smart enough. I was afraid I was not enough. I was afraid of what other people would think. I lived my life afraid. And if I could go back and do it again, I wouldn't live that way. I'd live with a little bit more faith. I'd live with a little bit more intention. I'd surround myself with better people. I'd do really easy things and I'd generate some momentum. I would connect my love for my family to be greater than my fears. Yeah, that all sounds really good, but you don't get to do it again. That was your one life. Welcome to hell. Live with it forever. You just need to decide right now. You want to go to heaven or hell? That's what you need to decide today. I know most speakers end on a high. Stand up and give someone a high five. Here's what I want to end on. You. This talk today wasn't about me. I told you it would be an experience. I told you I had a general pretty good idea what we were going to do today. And I came here to tell you that my gift in my life, my honor, would be to be any little speck of sand in the beach of your family's life of helping you just make some changes. I don't know why, but I'm in this position that God gave me to help people, and I cherish it.